Good morning and a warm welcome to the fifth meeting of the Constitution Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee. As a result of proposed membership change, this will be Ms Weber's last appearance at the committee, and I would like to thank Ms Weber for her contribution during her time on the committee, and we wish you well for your new parliamentary duties. Agenda item 1 is decision on taking business in private. Under agenda item 1, members are invited to decide whether to consider evidence. This should be a private session. Agenda item 4, are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you. Agenda item 2, we're moving to our pre-budget scrutiny work. The committee is currently looking at the continuing impact of COVID-19 on the culture sector and its longer-term future. This will be the committee's third panel on the topic, and this morning we have two panels. Our first panel, we will hear from Lucy Cassett, Chief Executive Officer, Museums Galleries Scotland; John McVeigh, Chief Executive Officer of the Producers Alliance for Cinema and Television, PACT; Alison Reeves, Scotland Manager, Making Music; and Fiona Sturgeon-Shea, Chief Executive Officer of the Federation of Scottish Theatres. And a warm welcome to our panel this morning. We are tight for time, as we do have two panels, so I'd be very welcome succinct questions and answers this morning. So I'm going to move straight to questions. Can I remind members, if they have a direct question for a particular witness, if they could name that witness and direct the questions. And I would request that the panel please come in only if you have something to add to what has been said by other members, as we do have considerable time restrictions this morning. So I'll move to questions from initially Ms Bolyak. Thank you.
And it's good to see the witnesses in front of us this morning. I wanted to kick off with a follow-on from last week's evidence and ask PACT, John McVeigh from PACT, if he wants to give us a bit of information. In your evidence to us, you talked about the potential privatisation of Channel 4 potentially having drastic implications for our independent film and TV sector. We've got some very good evidence from the BBC about the importance of production in Scotland. I wondered if you wanted to talk about how we avoid the risk of recovery to the indie sector that you've talked about in your report to us.
Okay, thank you very much and good morning, everyone. And thank you very much for the opportunity to meet with you all today and help you in your deliberations, particularly looking forward to the recovery of our cultural industries, which is one of the UK's fastest growing parts of the economy. And a critical part of that economy is Channel 4. If you look at the multiples from Channel 4's own research into the local economy from spending on TV production in any part of the UK, but let's focus on Scotland, then you can see it has significant ripple effects across all of the cultural industries. We employ writers, actors, directors, designers, musicians. So any decline in spend from Channel 4 will have a further knock-on effect in the creative economy in Scotland. The major worry about Channel 4, we'll leave the remit to one side, because I think the remit can be delivered in a number of ways, whether it's in public or private ownership. But the major problem for the government's, the UK government's proposals for Channel 4 is Channel 4 is currently a publisher broadcaster, which means that it is not allowed to produce its own programming. The proposals for the current government are that whoever would own Channel 4 going forward would be allowed to produce its own programming. Now, this necessarily and logically means there will be a decline in commissioning from independent producers. Channel 4 relies on independent producers. It has quotas throughout London, and a significant amount of those quotas are met by Scottish independent producers. So if I'm the new private owner of Channel 4 and I have my own in-house production, the first thing I do is look at what slots I'm not going to commission from external suppliers. And inevitably, that will mean that Scottish companies will not be commissioned where previously they might have. So this will have, now, of course, the scale of that and when that is quite difficult to be precise about. But we have modelled that and we have some independent research which will show that over 10 years, that's a transfer of value from small Scottish SMEs, British SMEs, entrepreneurs. And I know you've met some of them. That'll be a transfer of value of 10 years of £3.7 billion to new private shareholders. That will mean a decline of opportunities, and it also means a decline of aspiration, because if I'm a new small startup business in Glasgow or Dundee or Edinburgh, and I have an idea I think would work really well for Channel 4, I may no longer have that opportunity because those slots may no longer exist. And of course, Channel 4 has served a critical purpose over its nearly four decades in the TV sector, in that it is meant to support small SMEs and startups. That is part of its primary public purposes. And that allows me to aspire to work for Channel 4. Now, if I'm successful and I do make that programme for Channel 4, I am now a network production company and I now have an opportunity to supply to other broadcasters. So the ripple effects on this going downstream are considerable, not only in terms of actual reduction in spend on existing companies, but also a reduction in the potential aspiration and ambition of new businesses. And we think this is very detrimental. Now the Westminster government has tried to reassure us how important the independent sector is. But of course, we have no idea what that means in practice. But we do know, and we have models, that if Channel 4 is allowed to make, own and control its own programming going forward, then there will be an impact on independent production.
That's very helpful. I noticed there was also a comment in your submission about the need for investment in training and new entrants to the sector from the Scottish Government as a response to COVID. And we had lots of evidence from freelancers last week. So it's to open the question up to the other representatives in front of us today about change that potentially could be made now. So briefly from PACT and then hopefully from the Federation of Scottish Theatres about potentially how theatres and venues could support freelancers remaining by having longer term contracts. So a brief comment from PACT and then maybe from Fiona from the Federation of Scottish Theatre.
Okay, even with my comments about Channel 4, we are experiencing a boom in production across the UK right now. We're short of at least 30,000 jobs, and this is an amazing opportunity in terms of the recovery of the UK audiovisual sector because of a number of interventions, both by the Scottish government's agencies and by Westminster, has led the UK to recover much quicker than our competitors. But that has resulted in an overheating of the market because production is now booming, which means we have a shortfall of jobs. And we would like to work with all administrations and parliaments to see how we can deliver more opportunities. These are high value careers and jobs, and we are currently short of many, many critical grades. And we would like to see more focus on that in order to remain competitive and in order to facilitate growth of Scottish businesses.
Thanks. And Fiona Sturgeon-Shea, welcome. We got evidence last week from Bechtu and the Musicians Union. We're particularly worried about freelancers and the issue about venues and theatres obviously not being able to have productions on as you've had in the past. I was wondering if you had a comment. It's almost a contrast from PACT, who's saying they've got lots of job opportunities, whereas in your sector we heard that people were losing out and that there was a need to maybe change how productions were commissioned. I don't know if you'd have a comment on that.
Sure. Thank you very much for the question. You'll see from our own submission that the freelance workforce is a concern that we've held for a long time. Our membership is now 50-50 individuals and organisations. So we're not just representing companies and buildings, we're also our membership also includes individual, and some of these are freelance employees as well. I would agree. Longer term contracts are one part of the solution. But I think what we said within our submission was also that it's not the only way. The reliance on organisations is not the only way to support freelancers, and they can be supported You know, I think the concept of being a freelancer is often something that needs better supported in general. So there's, I think, a bigger context to that. And certainly our members would welcome the opportunity to work with more freelancers. My previous job, I worked for Playwright Studio Scotland for 10 years, so I was working directly with playwrights, and those mutually beneficial relationships that can be built up over time are absolutely something that you know, we worked very closely with the FST and the wider sector absolutely on that. I think the issue comes back to also within our, what's within our submission around the complexity of business models and the long-term funding situation. So, you know, with more funding and more opportunities, we would be able to look at that fuller infrastructure and provide more support for organisations to do that, but also individuals.
So would your priority be more multi-year funding for the theatre sector? One of the issues got raised was about community access and about accessing existing facilities. Is that something that you're thinking about in terms of longer funding, but also a community impact that would support people to be in employment?
Yeah, absolutely. I think we're looking at the full picture. As I said, our membership is pretty diverse. It's not just you know, theatre buildings. It's right across the infrastructure. So I think what we're trying to do is show a fuller picture of the infrastructure and how that could be supported long term. So it's every aspect of it, not just prioritising one over the other. Which sounds very utopian, I understand.
On the, particularly that last comment from Ms Boyack, so I'll go to Ms Reeves first. I can remind all the witnesses, if they do want to come in on a particular issue that hasn't been directed at them, if they could put an R in the chat and it will be passed over. Ms Reeves.
Yes, good morning. Nice to be here with you representing the non-professional arts sector today. And as I said in our submission, the staff that we employ, the people that we pay in our sector, are almost always freelancers. There's very few people in full-time contracts in our sector. These are people who have portfolio careers. A lot of them are employed in the music education sector, so school teachers and college lecturers, or are professional musicians in their own right. So to support the people who are working in our sector, we need to make sure that their other work is protected as well. So we've done a lot of talking about instrumental music tuition in schools and how those people doing those jobs need to be protected as well. And of course, all these conversations about professional musicians working in the professional sector are really crucial to us as well. So we need to make sure that those people are protected in every element of their portfolio careers. And some of that is about how we protect freelance workers overall in society, isn't it? In our sector, we need to make sure that our groups are returning as quickly as possible so that people can get back to this strand of their work so that they can add it back into their careers. And that's why we need to make sure our groups are able to return as quickly as possible. And that is dependent on lots of factors at the moment, which I can talk about at more length if you'd like me to, or we can cover that in a different question.
Thank you. Can I bring Ms Webber in?
Yes, thank you, Convener. And I suppose it will come as no surprise if I frame my question in this regard. I mean, I'm moving to the Health and Social Sport Committee. And I suppose at that committee, it was mentioned that every committee should take a health approach to things when they're looking at how they assess things and allocate funding, I suppose. So this is for Fiona Sturgeon-Shea specifically, because in your impact of the performing arts section here, you speak about health and well-being, and that was obviously great to see that. So I'm trying to figure out, have you ever thought about, or have you measured this in terms of trying to translate that into a case for more funding if you can demonstrate the health and well-being benefit that your sector brings? And maybe can you explain a bit more about some of those tangibles that are being realised and what you are in terms of that health and well-being sector?
I'm sure there will be, sorry, there's a bit of feedback there, I think. I'm sure there will be studies. As a membership organisation, we haven't specifically done that, but I am aware of many organisations that are working really closely in that area, and that did begin even as organisations to work in that area and to evidence that really, really strongly. And I think more work definitely needs to be done in that area, I think, yeah, for sure. And if you need more evidence of that, I can obviously survey our members and get some really good case studies for you. If that would be helpful, I can provide that in writing.
Sit in, and I'll maybe go to Ms. Reeves as well for a comment in the wellbeing work. So Ms. Cassett first. Good morning.
Good morning. Thank you for having me along this morning from the Museums and Galleries Scotland. Just to say, we have done some literature review work around the evidence of impact of health and wellbeing, of museums and galleries on health and wellbeing, that I hope will be relevant, and we'd certainly be happy to share that with the committee, and I've got some nice case studies around that. I think one of the things in looking at this sort of idea of cross-portfolio working and the aspiration to cross-portfolio resourcing comes from some of these really strong exemplar projects that have run, and they tend to run as a sort of short-term project that tries to explore a particular area. But there's one example that perhaps gives us an indication of what might be possible, and that's the Football Memories Project. I'm not sure if you're aware of that project that has been run by actually the Football Museum that originated. But it's a project that's in partnership with Alzheimer's Scotland, and it's been running for over 10 years now. And that's one area where museum collections have been demonstrated to have really beneficial outcomes, health outcomes for people suffering from dementia. And through that project, which, because it's got a longitudinal sort of research study that shows that this is really beneficial and works, that it's the one example probably where there is now some money coming in from health boards. So the Greater Glasgow Health and Clyde have put money into that project, which has now been running for a long time. But there are lots of examples of projects where museums and galleries have offered programming, as have other cultural organisations, programming in support of autism, in support of a range of different health issues, where actually we know that this works, and there's research to show that it works. And what would be great to see is if we could start to mainstream some of those projects, rather than seeing those as short-term funded opportunities. And it's something that we've presented some evidence to the National Partnership for Culture on. We would hope that there might be some recommendations coming out around that further on later in the end of the year.
Thank you, and thank you for giving me an opportunity to say that Motherwell Football Club is an excellent example of this project. It was one of the pilots, so I know this project very, very well, and I couldn't speak highly enough of it, Ms. Cassett. Thank you. So I'll bring it in, Ms. Reeves. Thanks.
Yes, as Lucy was saying, there's lots of published research on the impact of arts on health, and definitely on music and health. It's a very well-established idea, and we can point you to some studies if you would like to look at them. But we see groups now who are specifically targeting elements of health that we know music is most beneficial for. So there's a big growth in choirs specifically for dementia, people with dementia and their families. And we're part of the Dementia Inclusive Singing Network, and that's a well-established idea that singing is very beneficial, also for lung health, and that's really relevant in this time. Here we have a group called the Chain Gang who support people with poor lung health, and they're actually doing some work on long COVID and looking into how singing can benefit that. So it's a well-researched and an understood idea that is beneficial, and to be able to monitor that specifically across our sector would be difficult, possible, and that's why we are always asking for music to be considered as under different national performance outcomes than just culture. So if it's considered under music, if it's considered under communities, then maybe we can start to see some monitoring of the impact across the country of music making on health.
Okay.
I
can bring...
I was just going to say one thing.
So yeah, sure.
It was an observation, and that was great to hear some of those examples, but they were all at the sort of elder part of the generation in terms of dementia. What I'm trying to get to, I suppose, is that health and well-being, and trying to really level up the agenda with those people that are in the deprivation, and provide, so that this provides a springboard for people to leave and give them the confidence if they've been in an abusive environment. That's the sort of thing in terms of that longer term, rescuing them when they're at the earlier part in their life rather than trying to treat the diseases at the end. But that was just where my... But it was great to hear some of those examples specifically around dementia. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Ms Weber. Mr Ruskell.
Just a brief supplementary, convener. If I could ask Alison Reeves then, I mean, how does that actually materialise in terms of funding and discussions with, for example, health and social care partnerships? Are there projects, are there music projects that are going to the NHS locally and there's a discussion about social prescribing and they're getting funding to do that kind of work? Or is this just a useful add-on which the NHS GPs may be aware of, that there's voluntary projects happening locally but there's no actual direct funding?
So I'm particularly representing the non-professional sector today, and it's something that we are very mindful of with the conversations around social prescribing of how we might engage with that. It's an occasional occurrence where you might get a project who has the funding to speak directly to healthcare, but in our experience, it's usually at the moment the projects themselves within the communities deciding that they want to have those conversations. We are not experiencing the health services approaching the art sector to ask for those partnerships. We don't have a clear view of how social prescribing might work for our sector. We have concerns over the resources that our sector might be expected to provide that we don't have, and because it's not clearly shown to us how those people who were coming from the health sector would be supported to move into our groups. We're open to those conversations, but we can't see a clear model yet that wouldn't rely on our groups making a lot of effort at the moment, and they are not resourced and they're not skilled enough to do that. So where we're open to having those conversations, we're certainly not seeing a model that we could engage with at the moment.
Thanks.
Saying that although this is our last formal committee taking evidence, we are having a round table tomorrow, and at the round table are a number of third sector organisations that are working with younger people using music and arts in that, so just to put that on the record. So thank you. I'm going to move now to questions from Dr. Allen.
Thank you, convener. Following on from some of the themes that have been mentioned there, I suppose I've got a general question followed by a couple of very specific ones. And possibly initially a question for perhaps Alison Reeves and Lucy Cassett. Given what you've said about the importance of the arts and music and museums in the community, do you feel that, since we're going to be talking about a budget at some stage, do you feel that budgeting recognises the importance of mainstreaming the arts? Now, I'm not going to be the person who goes on record and says that in the middle of a COVID crisis we should be talking about what the NHS spends on the arts, but everybody recognises, as you've said, that the arts have a benefit in health, they have a benefit in town planning, they have a benefit in business, they have a benefit in the community. Do you feel that we budget in a way that's joined up enough to recognise those things?
Ms. Sturgeon-Shea first, please. I know you maybe wanted to comment on the last question as well.
I was just going to come back and give a couple of examples in relation to the previous question, which were, you know, those organisations that I was talking about that have a long-term commitment in this, you know, in this area, and looking at, I know that you've had a submission from the Arts and Education Recovery Group. And I think that might be particularly interesting to look at in terms of some of that, organisations like Starcatchers and like Clown Doctors and Elderflowers, who absolutely work in those areas. So that could be interesting for the committee to have a look at. I'm sorry, you'll need to repeat the question in brief for me.
Well, my question was really, do we budget as a country that recognises the need to have joined up working between the arts and different sectors, or does the expenditure always fall on the arts sector to do that exercise?
Well, I think people work, individual organisations work extremely hard to diversify their income. So there are organisations that are receiving funding from a whole broad range, but it is difficult. And I think certainly within our submission, our members were calling for a kind of unity of all of those bodies and policymakers to look at that in concert, I suppose. So absolutely, I think it is difficult. While the culture spend is, you know, has been at standstill, it's been extremely, you know, essential and welcome, but it has been at standstill for a long time. So to be able to maximise those opportunities, I think what you're saying is absolutely right.
I'm going to go to Mr McVeigh, then Ms Cassatt and then Ms Reeves. It's just on these questions. Mr McVeigh.
Yes, thank you very much. I think it's a very interesting question. I think it's one that the pandemic has thrown into relief as well, is that Winston Churchill basically said, if it's not about culture, then what are we fighting for? Culture lies at the very heart of our health as a society, a civil society. It generates ideas, innovation, excitement, and also it generates business. It generates business growth. As I said earlier, we are experiencing a boom in TV production and film production across the UK. These are significant opportunities. We should be doing everything we can to find talented young people, get them into these industries. That can often be through third sector and local community groups. That's where I started in my initial experiences. And I think it's right and proper that all governments and administrations consider how culture and the arts play a more significant role than they're often credited for in the overall welfare of the population, not just in mental health and physical health, but also in terms of creativity. And we've seen a trend for too long in education moving towards which is often called STEM. I think it should be STEAM because I think the arts and creativity are what we need in the 21st century. And I just remind the committee that for 2 years running, if it hadn't been for film and TV production in the UK, UK GDP would have been negative. So, the economics of this are significant. And I commend all my other colleagues and witnesses on this for the work that they do to try and make sure that people can get access to the arts and get access to culture. For a variety of reasons, but I think there's a broader, more philosophical issue for all parliamentarians, MSPs, to consider why it is always separated into a bunker. So I think it's a very good question, and I don't think I've met, and I've given evidence to many administrations over the years, no one seems to want to grasp that this is actually a critical issue which should be embedded across everything.
Thank you. Ms Cassatt and then Ms Reeves.
Thank you, and it's an excellent question, and I think the simple answer is we don't recognise it enough. And I think one of the things that's really important at the moment is to understand the pressure that there is on organisations, and particularly I'm thinking here about civic museums. There's been some fantastic practice that some of our local authority museums in particular have led in this area in terms of additional programming that they've run for young people at risk, fantastic programmes that have run, but they've run through culture budgets. And what we're seeing and what we're particularly concerned about is that pressure on local authority and civic museums that does apply across the piece, that these are the programmes that are easily lost because the core purpose of museums, they have to care for their collections, they have to open their collections up to visitors. And therefore, this fantastic programming that we know works and we know has the benefits that are being proven through research are the things that are first to be cut. And that's where, I mean, I suppose the alternative ways of looking at is you could say that we need more money coming from the culture budget to do that. But is there an opportunity to look across portfolios to say if those benefits are really going to young people at risk, or if those benefits are really going to people with dementia, are there other ways that we could join that up to think about how that is funded on a more holistic basis? And I think that the reliance on those individual institutions to identify those opportunities and develop those programmes. There's been a huge amount of work, really ambitious and fantastic work that's gone on. But with a more coordinated approach, we might be able to grow that. And otherwise, I think we're going to start to lose it and go backwards, and that would be a huge loss. And I just want to make a very quick plug on something with a different hat on. I'm a trustee of the Arts, Culture, Health and Wellbeing Scotland, which is a new charity that's trying to do a lot of this work of bringing together the practice between health and social care and between the arts. And we've run a series of events, and I'd be happy to provide some information to the committee on that if that would be helpful. That particularly answers some of the social prescribing questions as well.
Thank you.
Alison Reeves, I declare an interest in someone who is, for obvious reasons, a not very active at the moment participant in a Gaelic choir. Can I ask about community music in terms of some of the problems that have faced community, the making of music in the community over lockdown, and how you're now working to overcome that? And also, perhaps related to that, an issue that's been brought to this Parliament's attention in the past has been about making sure that we have a supply of music teachers in schools, given that at the moment the majority of those are essentially, as I understand it, someone will correct me, coming through the private sector rather than through the state sector. So it'd be interesting to hear about those two issues, what's happening to music in the community and what's happening to music in schools.
Well, it's great to hear that even
I think I've lost the feed.
Our community.
So sorry, Ms. Reeds, we lost your feed for a second there. Could you start
again?
Can
you hear me now? Okay. Am I back on?
Yep.
I was just saying it's really good to hear that Alistair is continuing occasionally to sing, as do so many people continue to do as adults, sing and play musical instruments. And it's such a massive, vibrant and often unnoticed element of our culture, society. I think before I explain the problems to returning, I think to your previous question about investment in community music making and non-professional sector, it's interesting because it doesn't all come from culture funding. In fact, hardly any of it comes from culture funding. Some of the investment is in performing arts venues, which our members use, and also, as I said, those freelancers who are also professional musicians. But a lot of it comes from investment in communities. So it's the community hall, which use the school buildings and the halls that we currently can't access, public transport, all those things that enable people to move around in their communities and use community spaces, they prop up our groups. And that's one of the things that's causing us the most challenges returning, actually, is that infrastructure. So the biggest, most common challenge at the moment is accessing suitable venues. So when I say a suitable venue, I mean one that is often bigger than the venue that people were previously using, because they're still feeling the need to physical distance. So we're seeing groups having to move from a smaller hall into a bigger, for example, church space to accommodate the physical distancing. They're very worried about ventilation, and the infrastructure in this country is designed to keep heat in small Scottish halls, rural halls. So ventilation is very problematic, and having access to those spaces is really worrisome at the moment, especially with the school estate being largely closed to external lets at the moment. So that is our biggest challenge. And if we can move that forward, the investment in public buildings, in those arts venues that the theatre sector have talked about using, that's really going to make a big difference to us. Alistair, can I ask you to repeat your question about music teaching specifically?
The issue there was really that in the past, I know that other committees in the past have had representations from people in the Royal Conservatoire asking whether there is a sufficient sufficient supply of music teachers in schools for the future.
So we are a member of the Music Education Partnership Group, and they would be the best people to give evidence on that particular particular question. I think that with the move to make instrumental music tuition free in schools and the move to make music teachers GTC registered, I think both of those things are going to hopefully make music teaching in the state sector a more desirable prospect for those people. And those are the people who have these portfolio careers that I'm talking about, who are also our music directors, our choir directors as well. So they usually have a foot in that career as well.
I declare another interest, not a financial one, of an interest in historic ships, as those who know me well will confirm. I noticed that Museums, Galleries Scotland, that your evidence pointed specifically to issues facing historic ships, and I was just curious to know more about that.
Yeah, I think one of the things that is put to museums and the challenge at the moment is the basic running costs that they have, whether they're open or they're closed. And some of these assets are really, really expensive to look after, and that does include historic ships, but it was kind of illustrative of I suppose, the wider point around the challenges that museums and galleries have been facing. So we put some figures in our evidence about the degree of challenge facing at the moment, that 2 years into the pandemic, there's a third of our museums and galleries haven't opened at all in those 2 years, and they're now facing another winter as the tourist season comes to an end. And yet the running costs that they face throughout that time are high for many of them. And so the challenge that's been in terms of the hit on their reserves and their ability to meet that, and particularly there are some of those that are independent museums, independent charities that don't have the security of national ownership for those collections. So there's a particular challenge if any of those organisations do fail. And that's a real worry for us. The last survey that we did in mid-July suggested that of those museums who responded to our survey who were open, none of them were running at a profit. So it was a less of a loss by being open. They could sell some tickets. But the funding that we were able to distribute last year, for which we were enormously grateful and is absolutely essential lifeline to our museums and gallery sector in its survival through so far in the pandemic, and that funding ran out in June, whereas some of the wider funding through Creative Scotland to the arts sector has carried organisations through to September. So there is a real challenge facing those organisations in getting through to their ability to start earning income again. It's a pretty seasonal, for most of the sector, it's a very seasonal business. So what we're really flagging there is the concern, particularly for independent museums, that there isn't that safety net of public ownership for those collections, and some of those assets are really expensive to look after.
Can I bring Ms Boyack in for a quick supplementary, please?
Yeah, it's been good hearing about the potential issue of getting more people to access the arts. It was just something in the museum submission just about the issue of the commitment to everybody having a right to culture. And it was a suggestion in there. I just wondered if you'd like to mention it, Lucy Castle, about the concept of having a minimum acceptable standard of cultural provision that would address the issue about we've got lots of fantastic museums, but the focus is on preserving them, not about promoting access. Now, that might be challenging in terms of funding, but do you want to say a bit about that? Because it's quite an interesting idea that actually might do the joining up across portfolios that we've just been talking about.
Yeah, no, thank you very much. And yeah, we've given quite a lot of thought to this question of what sort of change might be inevitable, which is fundamental to the questions that you put out in the consultation around if change is inevitable, are there different ways we could think about funding? And it's such a diverse, I mean, even within the museum and gallery sector, it's hugely diverse, and here the culture sector much so, more so beyond that. And so the challenges and the opportunities are very different for different parts of the sector. What is facing the civic museums is different to the independent museums, is different to the challenges facing our national institutions. But the principle of access to culture, it seems to us to be a really valuable one starting point, because actually if we establish that as the right, as what we're trying to achieve, then it might start to point towards not necessarily a blanket solution across different parts of the country, because different parts of the country operate in different ways. And so in terms of the museum sector, in some places, the local authority is really, really strong in delivering. In other places, there are really, really strong independents. So saying that the solution be to do a particular thing that addresses that through either one of those seems to be something that we'd certainly want to look at and perhaps tease out. But if we can start from thinking about what are we trying to achieve here, what we're trying to achieve is public access to publicly owned collections, or the collections that tell the story of our country, then that perhaps provides that the structure around which we could consider the options for how best to achieve that. Because what we don't want to see is unmanaged change that just sees us, you know, some organisations failing and then trying to fill in the gaps. And if we can think strategically now about what we're trying to achieve with the sector, and then look at what the specific challenges are, and the fact that, say, those are probably different in the Highlands and Islands than they might be in the city of Glasgow, you know, and actually, so one size fits all solutions to that might not be easy to achieve. But if we're very clear that everyone should have access to the collections that are relevant to their area, then that would be a principle we could then explore with the sector, the best way to achieve that. Because at the moment, that there's lots of really helpful signposting from Scottish Government of creating that right to culture, but then a duty to report on how that is achieved in different parts of Scotland could be something we think is worthy of further investigation.
Thank you.
Mr. Ruskell?
Yeah, thanks. I just wanted to go back to Lucy's points about assets and managing those assets over time, and particularly in relation to, you know, future-proofing, reducing energy costs, investing in buildings to make them climate resilient as well. I used to sit on a trustee board of the Smith Art Gallery in Stirling, and we're going through a period of, you know, expansion and changing the business model a bit. You know, it's challenging in terms of getting advice and support and bespoke funding. So I'm wondering what that landscape looks like. Is there bespoke funding that's available now for museums and galleries and other organisations to be investing in these changes, or are you looking to build that into your mainstream funding if you're going to Heritage Lottery Fund or whatever to fund that sort of work?
So there isn't bespoke funding for it at the moment. It's clearly one of the major challenges that we face, that we all face, but specifically with my responsibilities in trying to support the museums and gallery sector to do this. We are seeing an increasing number of applications through our open fund. Now, our open fund, we've got £1.1 million a year to distribute from Scottish Government, which doesn't go very far across, you know, 430 museums. But what we are seeing, and the desire from the museums to make those changes, because they make sense for them for all sorts of reasons, such as, you know, reducing their own running costs by insulating their buildings properly. But a lot of our museums and galleries in historic buildings, great in relation to embodied carbon, really important that those buildings are looked after. But some particular challenges around adapting those to meet the obligations that we all have. So there will absolutely be a requirement for funding to come through to support museums and galleries to meet those, as there will be across the cultural estate. So yes, we would very much welcome a discussion about, and we are actively looking at where that funding might come from, and indeed to talk to the National Lottery Heritage Fund about that as well. But it's a huge challenge, and I think museums and galleries not only need to do that in relation to their own estate, but the other thing museums and galleries can do is to help with the public debate and the discussion. You know, there's trusted venues that deal with complex subjects that can help in informing and opening discussions with the public around that. And that's something we've been trying to do in relation to some of the work we're doing around COP and COP conversations, which is again across the culture portfolio and climate beacons, in trying to identify those projects that can inspire action and really trying to tease out what that might look like. But there's no question it's going to need investment. So I'm very keen to identify the best way of doing that.
Okay, thanks.
I think we have another question regarding museums, but if I could just remind people, if they want to comment, if they could put an R in the chat, but I'll go to Miss Minto again for Miss Cassett, I think.
Thank you, Convener. It's actually slightly wider. And before I start, I should refer everyone to my register of interest and the fact that I'm a trustee of a small independent museum on Islay. And what I wanted to widen out the conversation around was really looking at the impact of the pandemic on the whole area of arts and culture, and the way that funding came to each of your organisations, and basically what you have learnt from that funding, in that it was a far quicker process in some respects to get funding out to people that needed it, but also from the staycation perspective and the importance of not just investing in the Central Belt. More people are coming out to the wider parts of Scotland and how your areas are supporting that shift of visitors from a culture perspective and telling the story of the areas that people are visiting. So I don't know, Ms. Cassatt, if you want to start there, or should we give you a bit of a rest?
Well, I'm happy to start and to be I suppose reasonably brief, because I think we've covered some of it in our submission as well. But one of the things, I mean, so we distributed £9 million last year, in contrast to our usual £1 million, and we're enormously grateful for the support that enabled us to be able to do that from Scottish Government. One of the decisions we took early on in that was to support, our funding normally just goes to accredited museums, so that's museums that meet the established professional standards for the museum sector, but about a third of our museums are not accredited, but are enormously important in their communities as community assets. And as you say, telling that story of Scotland, and they're not all in more remote places, but many of them are, and many of them are run by volunteers. So we thought that was such an important part of the wider museum sector and museum estate that we extended our funding to them, and we've continued to do that this year as well, because they've been essential parts of that. And in terms of the volunteering, the wellbeing benefits that comes from that volunteering, and as them as sort of symbols in their communities, in some cases for running the only cafe on an island, or you know, the importance of those as venues, not just as museums, but as parts of community life, has been really important. So we've changed the way we do that funding. Our ability to continue to do that depends on whether we would continue to have the resource to be able to do that, but we certainly would hope to be able to do that. And once we've got that wider network of organisations, we can then support them to work towards those standards where that's appropriate for them to do so. So that's been a really important piece of learning for us, but we've been astonished by the response from the sector and the creativity with which people have met those challenges, and the generosity in many cases in which organisations have collaborated and worked together in shifting to digital and all the rest. And there's loads more I could say, but I should probably let others come in, but I'm happy to answer any follow-ups on that if that's helpful.
Mr. McVeigh, thank you.
Yeah, oh, thank you very much. Yes, I don't know much about funding for museums in Scotland, but I would like to commend Screen Scotland, the screen agency for film and TV, who reacted very quickly, and you'll be hearing evidence from Isabel Davis, I think, in your next session. But I would really commend the quick response that they did to the COVID pandemic and the impact on Scottish film and TV producers, where they were able to make significant resources available to maintain development and maintain companies actually developing ideas for when the market reopened, which it thankfully did. And I think it was an exemplar to many other agencies across the UK who perhaps didn't do as much. And I think it was a very welcome response. And I know from my members in Scotland that they really felt that they were being supported through, when basically the lights were switched off for quite a long time. So I think it's a good example. And we worked very closely with Isabel and David Smith on that, and they were both very responsive and acted very quickly.
Can I bring in Ms. Sturgeon-Shea and then Ms. Reeves?
Hi there. Yeah, it was just to really echo the other two speakers, just to say about the resilience of the sector and the reach that was extraordinary in terms of, in the middle of a pandemic, being able to pivot so quickly to digital and all the other kinds of work that was happening that couldn't happen face to face. So in terms of the place question that you were asking about what work was happening in different places across Scotland, I was aware of really innovative projects happening in the Highlands and Islands, in Dundee, Dumfries and Galloway, Perthshire. The Air Gaiety ran some really extraordinary both community projects, but also digital. So I think the reach has been extraordinary, and the access that was provided, and that kind of I suppose extreme localism that happened, but also that was also available worldwide. So I was certainly aware of individual artists who were putting their work out there and getting audiences that were beyond their wildest dreams, really, by being able to do that. So I think there will definitely be lessons, and there'll be thinking within those organisations and within those individuals about how, you know, the lessons that can be learned and how those connections can be maintained in the future. And that's certainly something we've been keeping an eye on and are helping people to expand on as much as we possibly can. I think the youth theatre sector responded extremely well as well, and that was in part to with availability of funding from Creative Scotland, who I know you're going to hear from. I think I've given some examples in terms of the bursaries that were available to freelancers that were hugely appreciated and very quickly turned around. So I would echo some of what John was saying. Thank you.
Ms. Reeves?
So in terms of what we learned about the funding of our sector during the pandemic, so we had about 18 months when our groups couldn't meet and make music together in person. And the funding benefits were really there for propping up freelancers, for continuing to enable them to work. And they were able to move to a digital model where possible. So that was really excellent. All the emergency funding that was available through Creative Scotland and the other ways that those people were continuing to be paid meant that they could continue to work for us. And you'll all remember that incredible digital response that we saw from choirs and bands and orchestras making stitched videos and virtual performances and so on. So that was really crucial, still having those people being able to do those quick turnarounds and the phenomenal response and the huge amounts of learning that they needed to do. Having the availability of small, quick-to-access funding was really crucial for us. So those little pots of money that didn't take much to apply for, which enabled people to run small digital projects and upskill themselves and buy new software and so on. And at the moment, that is really beneficial as well. So people using funds to, for example, buy face coverings for the whole choir so that they can sing safely, that's been really useful. But what we are now noticing is that funding for the venues infrastructure, as I've mentioned, is absolutely crucial. So making sure that those performing arts venues are open and well ventilated. But it's also, like Lucy mentioned, the museums and galleries are spaces that our members benefit from, libraries, community spaces. So that's really crucial that the funding for those venues is there, but not just to open, but also to adapt and change ventilation systems, new hygiene systems, and all those things that we need to move forward. So that's really crucial. In terms of communities and staycations, well, music making is everywhere right across the country, and the benefit of having a very rich and vibrant community music making culture is that when tourists visit those areas, then they have a lovely access to our local culture. So the Gaelic choir singing on the Gala Day is what they're looking for. It's what they want to see. And we missed our Gala Days so much this year and our festivals, and we would really need to see them coming back next year, and so that the staycationers can enjoy their own culture in these beautiful environments.
Thank you. I'm going to move to questions from Mr. Cameron.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. You've covered this in some of the answers you've just given in relation to emergency funding that you've received. And I think I'm comforted and reassured that it is reaching, filtering down to your members and staff and individuals as well as organisations. If I can, could we look beyond COVID, and that's not to diminish the challenges that the pandemic currently poses, but if we can look beyond COVID to the next year or so, when hopefully we emerge from it, what do you think the sector will look like, and how should it be funded? And perhaps we could touch on the question of multi-year funding, which is also important. And can I start with Mr. McVeigh, please?
Thank you very much. Well, as I said in my opening reply to an earlier question, we are experiencing a boom right now. I wouldn't say we're post-pandemic, but certainly for film and TV production in the UK, we are at higher levels of production than we are pre-pandemic. So I think the recovery is well underway. There's a number of things that underpin that. One is the extensive safety protocols that the industry developed with the health authorities across the UK, which have proven to be very effective. Two is a UK government-backed indemnity fund for production insurance, which we hope will be extended and will lead to further recovery. And three is the role of your local agencies, screen agencies, so Screen Scotland, being able to continue to support and invest in growing Scottish companies that will create employment, which will create ripple effects in the broader creative economy. And I think looking carefully at how Screen Scotland are resourced going forward through multi-annual support for the film and TV sector in Scotland would be very welcome. One of the other opportunities, which I know has been considered by local authorities and the Scottish Government, is film and TV studios in Scotland. Currently, we have a shortfall of studios in the UK due to the boom. That's leading to cost inflation, which can often be detrimental to smaller domestic producers who can't afford the rates that those studios may charge, which is what we're experiencing in the southeast of England. So in order to maintain growth for the audiovisual economy in Scotland, those are critical structural issues which need to be looked at, and they're long term. They're not things that can be delivered through single year funding. Those are long term investments. They facilitate cultural activity, they facilitate training and education, and they facilitate skills and growth in local economies. So I think those are precisely long term issues that I would encourage the Scottish Government to look at. And I would hopefully that would echo with my colleagues from the other sectors here that, you know, we've seen too many short-term funding for culture and arts under successive administrations across the UK, when actually we are the fastest growing part of the UK economy. So I think we should have long-term support and planning, so it allows people to become more innovative, to take broader investment decisions and to plan for growth going forward rather than continually having to run short-term projects.
And Shia, and then I'll bring in Ms. Reeves and then Ms. Cassett.
Yeah, definitely. I would absolutely concur. And I think the big thing to say is that this is going to be incredibly challenging, and it's still not over. I think we are still in crisis. And while the emergency funding that was provided was an absolute lifeline, I think there's a very important point that we make in our submission, which is about the ability to plan for the future, the ability to be able to have resources for the future that has not been able to be replaced by emergency funding. So the headlines really from our submission were about the possible necessity of additional relief and recovery funding. Just an acknowledgement of that. We don't have workable affordable insurance or confirmed emergency funding if the situation worsens. Investment in restart and renewal, which goes back to that point which many of our members made of the fact that there's been lots of investment in emergency but not in storing up for the future, and that reserves are very much at risk at the moment. And the question that we began with, Ms. Boyack asked me about freelance support, investment in skills development is going to be really important. And just to echo what John just said there, that long-term increased support to achieve maximum impact. So yeah, definitely long-term rather than short-term projects.
Ms. Reeves and then Ms. Cassett.
I would definitely agree with Fiona that we are very much in the middle of this crisis in non-professional music sector, and our members are really struggling with the amount of additional work they're having to do, mostly volunteers to get their groups running again, the increased costs, when we did our renewals last January, we had lost actually very few members in last year. We are expecting that to increase this year because reserves are being eaten up. Those very vulnerable groups who were, you know, all of our groups don't make a profit, they break even. And when there's any challenge to that, that's really problematic. So what I would also hope, though, is we may see some growth. There's been a real interest in music making, something that people took up or revisited in their lockdown periods. The high profile of those Irish orchestras and bands working digitally really increased the want and the need to take part in music. So I'm hoping that we may see some new groups as well as some increase in existing groups jumping up. But yes, the groups are very vulnerable. What's really going to benefit us is the funding of that infrastructure that I keep talking about. So multi-year funding, absolutely. And that to help the performing arts venues that we use and those freelancers in their professional careers. Yet we would always want that professional sector to benefit from that multi-year sustained investment so that that knock-on effect for those people making music in their leisure time is crucial.
Ms. Cassett.
Thank you. Yeah, so I'd agree with all of that about the tail from this situation. There will be a long tail for this, particularly for those who are reliant on international tourism normally for a bulk of their visitors, because I think some of these things are going to take longer to recover than others. We're going to have organisations going into the next few years with very low reserves and a lack of ability to sort of invest in maintenance and so on. But I think there's also been quite a lot of learning from this and new ways of working, new ways of collaborating and new opportunities in relation to reaching audiences in different ways that have come from this. And that the opportunity of multi-year funding is to get away from the, you know, short-term funding equals short-term thinking. I think that one of the things it would allow is to look more at collaborative working. There's been some great examples of that. For example, at Museums Heritage Highland that have done joint exhibitions digitally through this period and actually using the resources in a smarter way, which is going to be something that's going to be essential as everything, you know, is just going to be tight over the years to come. That with the ability to think longer, collaborative working and partnership working becomes a much more realistic possibility. Because the investment in time in developing a collaborative approach to something is much easier to take if you know you're in a three-year funding deal than if you're just trying to get through the next 12 months. So we would very much welcome the opportunity to do that, to make the most, I suppose, of the opportunities of the new ways of working and try and sort of smooth that any adaptation that we're able to make collectively as a sector. But at the same time, yeah, that ability to invest in the venues, in the adaptation that's required, we'll still take some additional support to get through to the survival element of this, to be able to then thrive on the other side of it is essential. So thank you.
Thank you. If I can ask a final question, it's really for Mr. McVeigh. I suppose the news from the screen industry is very positive, which is something we don't hear a lot of right now, post-COVID in recovery in terms of the economy. But it's to understand some of the challenges around that 30,000, I think you said, gap in jobs in the sector. So I'm thinking of, obviously, that could never be fulfilled from purely, you know, people who are living and studying and working in Scotland at the moment. So has there been any impact to the Brexit situation in terms of people? Do you have people coming from Europe and from out with Europe and wider to work on these productions? And has that been a challenge for you? And also, what we've also heard is many, many people have left industries where there's a reliance on short-term contracts and freelance-type contracts because of lack of job security, and whether the sector is remodelling how it might work in the future in terms of job security.
Okay, quite a lot of issues bundled there. Well, clearly, during the pandemic, it was difficult to bring in non-UK workers because of various criteria around quarantining, etc. We did have an exemption which was brought in, which was then suspended and that's just been reintroduced, which means we can bring in talent, particularly if we, you know, if they're lead actors from America, we can bring them in without having to go through the full quarantine process, because they can immediately, they can arrive and go into our COVID bubble protocols for production, because production is effectively a closed environment generally. Pre-Brexit, we did bring in crew from other European countries, which was very easy, but not a lot. It was never a big thing. We're not getting a lot of feedback from the members that that is currently a big problem. But actually, I think the real issue is how do we, as an industry and others, invest in the skills and the talents that we have in order to fulfil those 30,000 jobs. We did a survey of our members across the UK, and 80% of all of our members furloughed freelancers, even if they didn't have to. They went through the process of having freelancers furloughed. And as I say, given the boom we're experiencing, I would imagine the vast majority of those people are back working, which is what we wanted to do when we set up the restart fund, which was the indemnity fund for insurance, because we explained to the Chancellor that much better to get people back to work rather than sitting on furlough and not being productive. And that's led to unprecedented levels of production right now. Rates have gone up, so I can't imagine anyone's leaving the industry right now, where we're seeing, in some cases, for some jobs, a 70% premium on pay rates. So because everyone's trying to get back to work and put money back in their bank accounts, and quite understandably. So, we've also seen, to my colleagues from the theatre sector, we've also seen production in Yorkshire retrain people from the theatre sector who were furloughed because they couldn't get back to work, and they've now retrained to work in film and TV. So I think this is a first world problem we've got, which is we need a lot of talented, skilled people, and it's a huge opportunity. It's a huge opportunity for audiovisual economies across the UK to meet, and to, that will lead to further growth and development, and that would be a good thing.
Thank you. I didn't think anyone wanted to come in on this, but I wonder if Ms Sturgeon Shea wants to make a comment about the possibilities of cross cooperation, or would it worry you if a lot of people in the theatre were leaving to work in the screen industry at this time?
I think it's already started happening. I know you've had evidence from my colleague at Beck too. It's a massive issue for us, and it's in our submission about the skills gap that's potentially going to be left. So yeah, it's not a competition, and it's great that people are, freelancers are being supported in other ways, and they've always worked in, in different areas, either adjacent to theatre or in completely different areas in those portfolio careers that Alison's talked about. But no, definitely that's kind of where that, the skills development side of our submission is very much focused on that. We need to retain, but we also need to definitely attract new talent as well, and support that talent, because I think it must have been a really difficult time to be leaving education or trying to enter an industry that was effectively closed for nearly 2 years. So we do have a massive challenge ahead for us in that situation.
Thank you for that, and I think the concerns from the different areas of the sector have been well voiced this morning. Thank you very much for your contribution. I'm not seeing anyone else indicating they want to come in, so I'm going to suspend the session for 5 minutes while we change over panel. Thanks.
for both.
So thank you and welcome back. We now have our second panel this morning, and if I could introduce Ian Munro, Chief Executive of Creative Scotland, and Isabel Davis, Executive Director of Screen Scotland, and remind everybody, please try and be succinct as we want to get through as many opportunities for questions as possible, and I'm going to invite Mr. Cameron to start.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to our two panel members. I'm going to, if I can, ask a question to Creative Scotland, to Mr. Munro, about the funding awards to local authorities. We've been provided with a very useful table of all the local authorities in Scotland and the awards, and it's quite hard to draw out any patterns from it, but it does seem to be clear that obviously Edinburgh and Glasgow take a large amount of funding, and it also appears that the five local authorities with the lowest per capita funding from Creative Scotland all share a boundary with either Edinburgh or Glasgow. And I just wonder if you have any comments about the spread of funding across Scotland by local authority. Any observations, I'd be very welcome to hear. Thank you.
Thank you, Deputy Convener, and good morning to the committee. Thank you very much for inviting us to give evidence. Good to have the conversation this morning. So on local authorities, there are a number of dimensions to this. So if I start with the overall context, I think it's important to recognise that we, as Creative Scotland, work right across the geography of the 32 local authorities across Scotland in a variety of different ways. Sometimes that is at policy and strategic level, sometimes that is through funding interventions and so on. The other bit of context is that the patterns of what we call the ecology of support that exist across the country do see a predominance of organisations working in the creative sector centred around the higher population centres, so the main cities, particularly Edinburgh and Glasgow, but not exclusively. But one important dimension to this to recognise is that that does not mean that they limit themselves to only operating and delivering programmes of activity in those particular areas. So, for example, just as a simple illustration, the 121 organisations that are supported through our regular funding programme currently, three quarters of them work beyond the geographic base location in other and all parts of Scotland in some cases. So I think the pure sort of arithmetic analysis of the data on tables only tells part of the picture in terms of where the impact and the reach is actually felt. The other thing is that audiences themselves don't operate within local authority boundaries. They will go to where there is activity or work that they want to see and experience and be part of. So they travel across geographic locations to be able to do that. And we also know that there are some areas of the country where We want to see more progress in terms of local opportunities for activity to happen. So we actually work in a very targeted way beyond open application processes like the emergency funds have operated, which, you know, naturally generate their own applications from the local areas. We look at all of that data and identify where we might want to do more targeted activity, be a bit more active in terms of being on the ground in those areas, attending funding fairs, working with local authorities and local groups, as well as some strategic programmes around things like our place partnership work, where we've worked with a variety of areas, including the local authorities themselves, but with cultural organisations in those areas, to try and move on and build their capacity to be more confident in their communities about what they want to see and do, and then find ways of strategically enabling that. And that then leads to subsequent project-based activity or the kind of growth of local activity that we can find various ways of supporting. So it's a complex equation, but I think we do our very best to understand what that landscape looks like and work as hard as we can to try and enable access and spread the benefits of the funding support, but also that development role that we've got to work with and through people in the local area to do what they want to do.
Thank you for that. If I could just drill down a bit more into the detail, and I fully accept what you're saying about being wary of reading too much into this, but one point I noted was that in terms of the percentage of successful awards, over half of the local authorities come below the 50% mark. And I just wondered why that was. Is there a reason for that?
Sometimes, but not always, it's down to volume of applications in the first place coming forward, which arises from capacity challenges and confidence within the local area to have people coming forward to be able to make those applications. So that, I go back to my previous answer to refer to why we would understand that at a local area and intervene directly in terms of our presence in the area, as well as where appropriate, intervening with funding. So we can talk with people at a local area about funding opportunities that we can make available alongside others, as well as brings forward some local areas into a strategic programme like the Place programme, or indeed the recent, through the emergency funds, Culture Collective programme, where it absolutely is investing in local communities, particularly those that are hardest to reach or have been served less well in terms of the funding patterns so far.
So one example of that, which I was very struck by, was Aberdeen City, which is, you know, one of our major cities in Scotland, and yet its funding per capita is £4.67, compared to Edinburgh at £51, Glasgow at £34, and Dundee at £21. And, you know, that strikes me as an example. And if you look at and you look across, the amount of applications made is actually relatively small in proportion to the others. And I just wondered, I mean, that strikes me as a bit of an anomaly, but is the issue because fewer applications are made from one of our major cities? Is that the reason?
Yes, it has been our experience for a number of areas where the volume of applications is actually low, but the success rate on those applications tends to be high. So whilst there are a few applications coming in, they tend to be successful in securing resource. But the other point I would note here is that we are only part of the ecology of support for organisations in local areas. And of course, local government in particular has a very key role to play in working alongside any resources that come from us as the national body into different local areas. And I'll give you another illustration. Our average intervention rate across the 121 regularly funded organisations in the current programme, our average intervention rate is a quarter of turnover of those organisations. Now, of course, that varies according to the different kinds of organisations that are funded there through the 121. But on average, it's a quarter, which means, therefore, that three quarters is coming from a combination of public and private sources, earned income through ticket sales, bar catering, retail, retail participation income, and so on. So local support is as important as the national support. And it's the picture together that becomes important, I think.
Thank you very much. My final question is to step away from that and to look at the issue of multi-year funding. I mean, time and time again, organisations that have appeared before us in the last few weeks have talked about the need for stability and security and long-term planning, particularly because of the pandemic. And I'd just be interested to hear your views, both you and Screen Scotland, if possible, on the issue of multi-year funding. Is it feasible, and you know, would you support it?
Definitely would support it, and definitely encouraged by the Programme for Government commitment around this and the manifesto commitment in the election. So, I mean, Creative Scotland, I can expand further in other questions if there are time around our kind of budget construct, just to explain it a wee bit more, because it also involves the National Lottery. But in terms of Scottish Government, we too are on annual budget cycles like many other public bodies, and indeed more than we would like in terms of the life of Creative Scotland. So far we've been on annual budget cycles. So the move towards multi-year funding does enable all of us to look forward with more confidence, to enable the kind of work and ambitions that I think we've all got to be able to support the sectors that we work with, to deliver for the public of Scotland, to be delivered to better effect than simple annual funding cycles that we're on at the moment. It was, Lucy Cassett from Museums Gallery Scotland submission and her evidence session earlier does make the point about short-term budgets can lead to short-term thinking. And I think that is the unfortunate reality. So the longer-term commitment will enable us to translate that, assuming that that's what comes through the budget setting process. That will enable us to translate that into the hands of the sector and the people and the organisations that we work with.
Ms. Davis? Ms. Davis?
Thank you very much, and thank you very much for the question, Deputy Convener. I wholly concur for Screen as well. In terms of companies in this space, to unpack that a little, if we start with cinemas, then of course that's absolutely the case that multi-year funding allows for multi-year strategy. And what we've seen acutely during the pandemic is the need for innovation around business models and that need to build an audience. The upside of the pandemic in the sense of needing to go digital is the ability to reach out across far wider.
Thank you. We've got a bit of a problem with the connection. I wonder if we could switch Ms. Davis' camera off and hopefully we'll be able to hear.
Sorry for that.
Sorry, Ms. Davis, are you still with us? We lost you for a while there.
Audiences, my video goes. I'm sorry about that. So cinemas for certain would benefit from multi-year funding, as some currently do under the regular funding organisation mechanism that we currently have. But as John McVeigh has highlighted, another acute issue for the screen industry is training and skills. And again, there is absolutely the need for some long-term thinking from our very strong local community of training providers in Scotland. So that's certainly something as well that we'd really welcome.
Thank you. Can I bring in Ms. Boyack, please?
Thanks very much, Convener. I want to ask a question. It kind of follows on about the multi-year funding, but it's also as well about the level of funding. And it's really a question to Creative Scotland. The evidence we've got from other written evidence from OSCAR and the Accounts Commission highlight the extent to which culture has been cut. The large number of charities that operate at a local level to deliver cultural services very badly hit during the pandemic. And the Accounts Commission highlight the extent to which culture has borne the brunt of service cuts in recent years. So just that question about... are we really underfunding the culture sector? Because we've had lots of great evidence of jobs, impact on the community, cultural well-being. Festivals Scotland told us that their members have had effectively a 25% cut over the last decade. So are we underfunding the sector generally, even before the pandemic? Because I think your budget is 0.2% the total Scottish budget. Have you got any comments about not just multi-year funding, but just the level of funding? Are we at the races here? Is it too low?
Well, the value that's delivered is enormous, but it is on relatively modest levels of funding compared to what I think we could achieve were more funding to be available. We know we've got a supportive Scottish government. And what flows into us from direct culture budgets is 0.2%. But I know that we could do so much more that would be transformational in terms of a relatively modest uplift in proportionate terms compared to that 0.2% for us, in how that would not just stabilise the very fragile sector that existed pre-pandemic, and has been writ large through the pandemic, and I too would share worries about looking to the future, and no doubt there'll be questions on that as part of this session. I'll certainly be happy to talk about it, but we've got to take care of the core foundations here, and I think the core foundations are very fragile. We all do our very best, us as a public development body, handling and passing on public funding for public benefit, but the businesses and companies that we support, as well as the individual freelancers and artists directly, are all in very fragile financial situations and would undoubtedly benefit from more stable funding, and from that foundation to create a springboard to deliver and unlock even more potential in terms of where we see opportunities beyond culture itself, but social value, economic value, unlocking those opportunities in the wider policy context around health and well-being, the environment, education and creative learning, skills. You know, there are many touch points here where the value can be unlocked exponentially with modest further financial investment. But we've got to take care at the moment, because of the pandemic is ongoing. We know that the culture sector more broadly has been one of the most immediately hit, the deepest hit, and will be for the longest period. So the pandemic is ongoing, but recovery is going to be slow. And I think there are lots of challenges in that. But what I'm saying is that I'm also interested in concepts of renewal, the opportunity, despite the adversity and the challenges, which we must, of course, take care of. The opportunity here is to understand the extent to which culture and creativity has been turned to and valued in the everyday lives of people during the period of the pandemic. Our research is telling us that 96% of the population have valued culture and creativity. So how do we harness that as an opportunity and place it into the heart of the future looking forward as part of a well-being economy? And that, as I say, goes beyond cultural value itself into these other social and economic value policy spaces. And it would genuinely be transformational. And it's probably a point at this point just to talk about Screen Scotland as an exemplar of what I think I'm illustrating. Because I think Screen Scotland, as part of Creative Scotland, was launched just over 3 years ago in August 2018. And there was a lot that led up to that moment, but the journey of success for that part of Creative Scotland is enormous and should be celebrated. But I use it as an illustration of what can be achieved with a combination of a set of factors that have unlocked that potential. One is overt direct political will and backing and a determination to make a difference. The second is the right people with the right knowledge and expertise and expert focus, which we've got right across Creative Scotland, but in this example, particularly Screen. The third is a modest financial enhancement. There was an additional £8.5 million from Scottish Government on top of the £10 million that Creative Scotland contributes to enable the unlocking of the potential for the screen industry. And yes, there is an additional element in screen at the moment, which is around the favourable sort of global market conditions for particularly the streaming platforms and high-end film and TV. So I think screen itself illustrates with that combination of political, overt political will and backing, the right people's skills, knowledge and expertise and focus and modest financial uplift could be replicated across wider parts of the portfolio of sectors that Creative Scotland works with in order to achieve the exponential growth that we're currently seeing in screen. So I think it's an important example to illustrate the opportunity that I think I'm talking about, but we've got to take care of the ongoing and long-term challenges of the pandemic. And there's a concept that I speak of, which is the risk of cultural long COVID, where you know the extent to which the ramifications of the pandemic on the sectors that we work with will take a long time to recover from. So we've got to take care of the core as well as think about how we can support through additional resources change to adapt to a new and different kind of future.
So what I wonder if Ms Davis wanted to come in just before you ask. Is there anything you wish to add, Ms Davis?
Thank you. On the point about Screen Scotland, I obviously would agree with that, that I think that our ability to bring in people from the sector into Screen Scotland who've been over the past 2.5 years, 3 years, highly dedicated to their particular fields. They come with very, very strong relationships into the sector, and we've been able to create a range of initiatives and bandwidth that have seen us really support the industry. John McVeigh was kind enough to point to the speed with which we were able to get emergency funding and subsequent funding rounds out of the door at the start of the pandemic compared with our cousins across the nations. And that's certainly due to both the in-house expertise and bandwidth, but the broader Creative Scotland body corporate as well, which has huge expertise across funding. I think one thing I would say is, in terms of skills and training, that bandwidth has allowed us to work incredibly quickly throughout the pandemic, including on that retraining of workers from theatre. So, for example, working with Skills Development Scotland through the National Transition Training Fund, we've been able to work with the Lyceum, for example, to put theatre workers onto shows like The Rig. I think there is a benefit to anyone's skill set if they can work across both areas. And I think that mobility of workforce, be that across performing arts and screen, live events, gaming, is going to be a feature of our workforce for the future in any case. So I think broadly it's been a real positive, as I'm sure others concur.
There's a follow-up question I had for Mr Munro about what would actually be the transformational difference, because it's getting through the COVID, as you say, and the submission you've put in is really powerful, that Scotland's creative industries contribute £4.6 billion to the Scottish economy every year, supporting 90,000 jobs. So what's the priority in terms of upping the investment that you can put in? We've heard a lot about training. There's been issues about investment in buildings, not just to get through COVID, but because a lot of our venues and theatres are quite old. What is the kind of additional funding that we need to keep things going, but also to invest to make sure that the sector is with us in the future, with the buildings and the people that we need in our communities?
So the context for this is to try and be sure-footed as best we can in a world that's still quite foggy in terms of how we can find our way through the ongoing pandemics, recovery is slow and so on. So if I can maybe just again do a wee bit of context here to be able to answer that question properly, because I think at this juncture, in September, there are a confluence of a number of pressure points that I'm really concerned about, and the implications of them to enable us to move forward in a confident way into the future without seeing major parts of the sectors that we work with collapse. And there is still a very distinct risk of that. And I think this is because people have depleted all their kind of financial resilience reserves and so on, as well as having accessed a lot of the support. So we right from the off were very clear that we and we swung into action and delivery on this essentially from day one. I want to thank the staff of Creative Scotland for all their hard work and dedication that's ongoing to enable this to happen. We knew that we wanted to provide and have provided support for both individual artists and freelancers as well as organising. We wanted to provide a combination of measures that were complete open access as well as strategically targeted measures, as well as the investment in both addressing issues of hardship and stabilising the situation, but importantly also about thinking and supporting people to change and look into a new and different kind of future. So that future is uncertain because what we're seeing is the prospect of patterns of cultural production and presentation and distribution and audience engagement potentially changing. You know, none bigger than digital, which only works in certain occasions for some, and is certainly no compensation or alternative to the live arts experience, which remains very important to support. So there's that kind of broader context, but there are six things at this point I'm very worried about that are adding to the mix. One is the end of furlough. The second is the repayment of business loans commencing. The third is ongoing and increasing inflation within the broader economy. The fourth is the retreat of public and private funding, so other sources being, you know, local government, other local funders, private business, philanthropy, and so on. The slow to return audience base, which of course brings with it not just participation and audiences, but income streams, and also a commitment to fair pay, which absolutely is unequivocal that we must address that. But that, of course, adds another dimension into the mix that puts pressure into the core budgets, which are already very thin, no financial resilience left within the budgets that we hold, let alone those that we're able to pass on to the organisations that we work with. So it sounds like a sort of heady cocktail of challenges. So the measures that I think need to be ongoing include further stabilisation coupled with support for change and adaptation for the future across five different areas. The one is supporting organisations particularly, but people too, to think about their business models. The second is to build and existing and new connections with audiences. The third is the role of digital, and we've been doing some work in these areas. The fourth is around capital, which is about COVID adaptations, but also climate change. And the sixth is around supporting organisations who may fundamentally want to restructure themselves with a different kind of vision or mission for the future, or indeed some who may feel that for whatever reasons are unable to continue. I would rather that was all supported, managed strategic change with the best outcomes intended than a reactive situation which has seen some parts of the sector collapse and we're intervening to try and recover some of the kind of lost ground. So that's about stabilisation and change, but it is in the context of also thinking about how can we see opportunities to bolster, indeed enhance core culture budgets, but also work in that collaborative way across these portfolios and other policy areas to unlock those opportunities and, where there's a mutual benefit, see those portfolio budgets also provide resource into the culture sector. Final thing is, when I talk about the cultural and creative sector, I need to be absolutely clear that we, as Creative Scotland, are not all of the culture sector. I'm sure that's understood by the committee, but just to be absolutely clear about that, we are not working directly with museums and galleries, historic collections, or...
Thank you. Can I move to questions from Ms. Mintle, please?
Thank you, Convener. I was interested in what you've just talked about, Mr. Munro, about the various challenges, and I'd be interested to hear more about the work that you hope to do around climate emergency and the sustainability plan. And also, I was really struck, I think it was in your evidence, and it kind of goes against what you've just said about different funding streams, the Creatives Rebuild New York and the philanthropy that came into that, and is that something that you're looking to explore within Creatives Rebuild Scotland? Because as Ms. Boyack said, the amount of economic benefit that the creative industry has put into Scotland is large. So I'm just interested to hear about these two slightly diverse, but all around about forward planning and finance.
Yeah. So the on that second point, and you'll need to remind me about the first one when we come to it in a second. But on that second point, yes. Well, I suppose I'm back to my proposition that we need to take care of the core first and foremost, which would merit enhanced additional financial resources to create a confident platform that you would then supplement with other income in order to unlock those wider opportunities. And some of that is about the cross-portfolio working that I've talked about, but some of it is also about where there might be new and different financial mechanisms to have a role to play in and alongside core subsidy, which will undoubtedly be a core requirement for the sectors that we work with, in large part as we look to the longer term. What I'm saying is that I think there's an enhanced need for that at the moment, but I think we've done a lot of work to, through our creative industries team in particular, to look at new complementary forms of finance that can have a role to play. Crowdfunding would be one, social investment would be another, and so on. So I think there are different mechanisms, but you can only get people into that space when they've stopped worrying about survival of the core. Channeling that energy into how they can deliver public programmes that are of public benefit. And your first question was about climate emergency.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
Enormously important, more so. I think one of the things, just by way again of macro context that we've been reflecting on in our own strategy, is there are three what I call tectonic plates moving around us at the moment. One is the pandemic that we've been largely focusing on. There is, of course, EU exit, and the implications and ramifications of that still being unclear and uncertain, but definitely problematic already. And the third is none greater than climate change. So that has all been in our thinking when we've looked ourselves at rebuilding a refresh strategy, which sees four areas of priority. One is around equalities, diversity, and inclusion. The second is around sustainability, which includes climate and climate emergency and the environment. The third one is around fair work, including fair pay, but you know, terms and conditions and skills and employment and so on. And the fourth one is international, where there's a very important dimension to thriving cultures globally. They thrive domestically when they're in an international context of import and export and exchange. So those four, EDI, sustainability, fair work and international, are the core things that we are focused on in looking to the future. And we can calibrate and recast different programmes, development programmes, as well as funding programmes, in alignment to all of those with more clarity is our intention. So on climate and emergency, it is an elevated priority. We've done a lot of work over the last 10 years with the sectors that we work with, in partnership with a key organisation that we helped establish some years ago called Creative Carbon Scotland, who are working with us at the moment to look towards what our next environmental action plan needs to be from 22 onwards for 5 years. But we've got a long term in our sights, And the work we've done so far has seen important changes within the sectors that we work with and support in a really positive way. But I think it's what I would call the low-hanging fruit of change. And some of the more thorny issues that we've got are the harder ones to tackle. That in themselves, I know that climate finance is going to be one of the major measures that not just the sectors that we work with, but the economy more widely is going to need to have in place in order to effect change. But we're determined to support through the work that we do and the work that we enable a positive difference in relation to the role that we can play in addressing the challenges of climate. And just very final thought on this, there are three dimensions to this. There's what we as Creative Scotland in the operation and delivery of our core work is for our business model, so the improvements we need to make there. That includes our renewables, our energy consumption, our travel and so on. There are those that we work with directly and how we can influence them and their behaviours to change. So again, we've worked hard to get climate action plans into environmental action plans into core organisations that we support, as well as through them, what they then go on to translate on stages through music, through books and literature, through visual arts programmes and so on to influence the public at large and opinion and behaviours and so on. So it's a kind of three-layered approach: us, those that we can influence directly in the sectors we work with, and through them, how they can go on to influence the public at large.
Okay, thank you. Can I go a slightly different question? Both in your submissions and also John McKay of PACT mentioned this as well. Research and development spend, I think you said how important that was to allow the creative industries to come up with ideas. I suppose I'm interested to know what's the success rate been in that, if that's a fair question?
I'm sorry, I'm not fully on the...
So can we go to Miss Davis first? It's just, I'm conscious you've been talking for a long time. I'll bring Miss Davis and we'll come back to Mr. Bruno.
I think in John McVeigh's report, he was talking about the UK government's R&D tax credits, which obviously sort of sits outside of our purview. The role of R&D, I suppose, in green sectors and film and TV, that would translate broadly to the development process, which is how ideas come about. So in the factual space, that might be lots and lots of ideas coming together quite quickly. In the film space, that's going to be possibly a more cerebral, longer-term effort. And it's something that is absolutely critical to the way that we work. And one of the developments, now that we have Screen Scotland, we have a broader base of execs, is to work much more integrally with the production companies on the work coming forward, where that's appropriate, where we're needed, which typically is in the film side of the space. If we're working to support scripted projects that are going to be commissioned by broadcasters or one of the streamers, then we know our place and we'll allow the commissioners to take that role. If you're asking about conversion, that's a really difficult question to answer because it varies so much and you know, deliberately, lots of things get thrown at the wall. Certainly in the unscripted space in TV, but that's true also of development. But we're seeing things come through faster, and we're also looking at the way in which we can play a much more proactive role as a production financier as well as a development financier in bringing forward work. So in fact, this year in the film space, we have backed with BBC Film, I should say, and the BFI, four first feature films, which is pretty unprecedented in given sort of recent years, that sort of volume of numbers. And we're looking at how we could more proactively be the first financier into a film. We can technically do that now, but I think the industry needs us to do that more, certainly as a national agency, to stand behind particular projects. So the issue there will be that, you know, if we're making financial commitments earlier on in the process, we can't do it for everyone. So again, it comes back to this question of what's the material, what do we feel can go forward, should go forward. But I'm afraid it's not a precise science in terms of conversion.
That was very helpful. Thank you very much.
Okay. Mr. Monroe?
Thank you. Yeah, in the broader arts space, I mean, research and development is at the heart of artistic development and innovation, and it leads to new creative ideas explored across the work of not just individual artists and freelancers and practitioners, but how that then moves into public programmes with audiences. So I think supporting individuals to unlock the potential of that through research and development is an important dimension to keeping a very thriving artistic and creative culture within the country.
That we got last week from the Stove in Dumfries talking about either supporting culture that's already here, but also supporting culture that's in being made and being created newly. So that was helpful. Thank you very much, Mr. Munro.
Thank you. Mr. Ruskell.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Can I start with a question for Isabel Davis, please? You might have noticed that in the recent cooperation agreement between the Green MSPs and Scottish Government, it commits to, and I'm just reading from it now, additional resources to Screen Scotland for the purpose of facilitating year-round engagement between the Scottish and international film and television industries with a particular emphasis on the USA. I'm just wondering what your reaction is to that and what you would see as being the priorities there in terms of ensuring that the best of Scottish talent is working internationally, but also that we're starting to bring in some of those productions into Scotland as well.
Absolutely. Well, I mean, as you can imagine, that was very welcome news for us to see that particular paragraph on page 7. You know, very pleasing news indeed. And we would say very prescient for international to be seen as such a tool of growth, both for, as you say, that the incoming production into Scotland, which we think has been a real success story during this pandemic. Scotland's fortunes have really changed for the better, I would say, extraordinarily, really, since the reopening of production in July of last year, with the opening of a new major studio in Scotland in Leith, which has already housed The Rig. It's now has a Nancy Boys in there who are in prep, you know, gearing up for production. But we also have Good Omens. We have a range of major film productions that have shot across Scotland, and really across the whole of Scotland over the past 12 months. So we see the international remit focused on the US as being absolutely key to that. I would say that the Scotland's ability to build on that picture is certainly, you know, strengthening the infrastructural side of our offer to the US, but also the skills side, which we talked about enormously. We could talk in far greater detail. It's something that goes across every skills grade, every part of the value chain, both for film and TV, right from early doors. And, you know, if there were time, we could talk about film education as well, even at school level. I think it's incredibly important. In fact, if I had some hindsight on the previous question, I certainly would have mentioned that innovation has to start with creative thinking in schools, and that's something we're actively engaged in pursuing as well. But to stay on point, certainly attracting production into Scotland, staying competitive around skills is a big part of that. But it's also about building our relationships and building our offer from locally originated content, which is an absolute must as well. And that's how we'll build resilience and sustainability, not simply by becoming a very successful service industry for US production, but by enabling our Scottish TV and film production companies to build stronger content themselves. And that side of the international picture, I would say, is about taking intellectual property, IP rights, developing them here, having them owned by Scottish companies, but developing them in such a way that they can hit the international market, whether that's by partnering with a streaming platform or by selling those rights territory by territory across international territories for broadcast or theatrical release elsewhere. So, you know, in a growth model that is successful, certainly we are committed and already engaged with developing material that can travel and developing the relationships through broader resource for producers in terms of the scale of what they can deliver, the amount of times they can travel per year, because relationships really do matter. It's not simply about having personal connections, but about truly understanding what a commissioner is looking for and having exposure to that commissioner and they having a really good understanding of what your work is, because that is what will determine their essentially their confidence, you know, in the pit of their stomach about what they believe you can deliver in the future. That's how people get commissioned. So there's plenty to do. We're keen to know how much of that resource we might have to play with, but we've already, of course, started to plan for how that might work across the what you might broadly call the skills development piece, export, inward investment, and co-production as well. I might mention at this point that we are very, very committed to working with Europe. We see all sorts of opportunities there across broadcast and film. And indeed, in early November, we are welcoming to Scotland about 100 independent European producers for their annual conference to meet the Scottish production sector as a show of warmth and strength in Scotland's intentions towards Europe in the future.
Great, thanks for that. Can I turn to Ian Munro? Now, and perhaps just sort of reflecting on what you said earlier on, Ian, about the big challenges that we face as a society and how that's reflected in Creative Scotland's objectives. I was reading your annual report and your annual plan, and it didn't really mention the word regeneration anywhere. And I was sort of curious as to why that is, because you talked earlier about the pandemic and also climate change. I mean, I think one of the consequences we've seen of the pandemic is that our high streets and our towns are dying. There's lots of empty spaces. Yet what I'm seeing is some creative groups coming in and actually repurposing our high streets and trying to draw more people back into our places. So I'm wondering where that you know, what you would traditionally call regeneration sits within your plan, and how much of your projects that you're funding each year are actually about that urban community-based regeneration.
So the word I am using is renewal. It's in the same sort of territory, as it were, but more broadly, the renewal word, I mean. But it includes what you're describing, and I mentioned earlier on, you know, the future is still unclear about how the world has changed, but it has undoubtedly changed, and there is no going back to status quo. So actually new and innovative and creative ways of where we've seen the importance of culture and creativity in local communities coming to life in different forms is emerging. And I think we are very interested in how we can support those opportunities in new and innovative ways, because some of that is actually about audience response to that, and actually what local communities want is more important than ever. So I think things are changing, and those kinds of opportunities that you've talked about in that sort of regeneration space are definitely part of what we imagine will be increasingly part of the new and different future, but it's in addition to some of those core cultural assets that already exist in current form, theatres and galleries and workshops and music venues and so on. But I think there are lots of opportunities in that, but and some of it you will see coming through in the Culture Collective programme, which is getting underway, having £6 million from the Scottish Government to kickstart that earlier this year. So that's working with 26 different projects and communities right across the geography of Scotland. So, you know, that is very much about local community-rooted projects. And Ms. Minto mentioned earlier the stove in Dumfries, where this is a classic example of what I think you're referring to in terms of local regeneration.
So, I mean, as part of that renewal, do you see the creative sector really leading that public participation? Because, I mean, you know, previously we would have seen perhaps councils or particular agencies trying to kind of lead that process. How much do you see the creative sector being involved? And, you know, you described, I think, what, £6 million from one fund. Is that funding particular like high street regeneration type work? And is it involving participatory conversations with communities to actually regenerate areas? Or is it?
Yes. It's a key part of it. And what we're doing through that programme is to connect all of those different communities together. And there are communities of artists as well as communities of the local population to learn and share and exchange their experiences. with a view to how that informs other programmes and projects going forward. So this wasn't a, this Culture Communities programme isn't explicitly just about community regeneration in local areas, but it's a key component, part of what will be achieved. And I think there's more that can be done in and around all of that area, because what we've seen is the importance to local communities to feel like they've got a democratic cultural voice to inform what is happening in their local areas is more important than ever. And it's how we can actually channel that working with the local community and local artists and cultural institutions in the area to really unlock the potential of all of that. But it will be so bespoke to the individual communities themselves as to the look and feel of finally what that ends up being and looking like. But there's an enormous, enormous potential in many aspects of the Culture Collective programme that will be of benefit to understand and then share more widely and see how that goes on to influence other forms of programmes and projects into the future.
Okay.
Ms. Weber.
Thank you, Convener. I suppose this is a follow-up, and some of the points I might ask for now you may have answered in terms of questions from others, but it's relating more to the fact that there's no capital budget for yourself. And we've just heard from Mr. Ruskell in terms of the renewal programmes that are needed for the industry and the sector. So the lack of capital specifically, how is that going to impact any ability to sort of kickstart that renewal?
Yeah. So earlier I'd listed, I think it was five things where capital was one of the five things that I think enhanced resources are required in order to adapt and change in that renewal looking towards the future. So it includes things like COVID compliance measures for venues and so on, as well as climate change measures, but also in terms of supporting the ambitions to enable local communities to have the kinds of spaces and opportunities that they want and need to have the best local cultural offer that not just satisfies them, but actually becomes so vital to their individual well-being and communities across Scotland. So absolutely, capital. We in previous years have largely funded capital from our national lottery budgets, but I mean, we have no financial headroom in effect within our overall budgets to enable capital programmes. We've got residual previous years capital projects that a small number now that are finishing, but we have no current financial headroom, therefore no plans currently to provide capital funding. But it is an important component, part of the overall ecology of support in order to move forward, I think, into the future.
Yes, thank you. Yes, in terms of all the other organisations with depleted reserves and no financial resilience, that's often where some small capital investment would have taken place. I don't know if that's relevant at all to Ms Davis in terms of Screen Scotland, if she wants to respond, but there's no assent.
Can you invite Ms Davis in?
Yeah.
Thanks.
Thank you. Well, what comes to mind, apart from the, certainly the role that we've been able to play infrastructurally with regard to Bath Roads, you know, there's no doubt that without a modest amount of support, that project would have stumbled, because there's for all of the extraordinary growth that we've seen in the production sector, actually the studio sector has a degree of market failure. So that was incredibly important. And the other example, and it, I guess, touches more closely onto the issue of retail, is the redevelopment of the Kelvin Hall in Glasgow, right in the city centre. And, you know, of course, that's a historic building that has been very worthy of public support, not support from Creative Scotland, but from Scottish Government. And again, looking at how that project will play out in terms of the redevelopment of its central space as an entertainment shiny floor venue, which is drawing audiences in to the centre of Glasgow, may very well co-host or have proximate to it the training associations as well. So something that can bring footfall into that part of town, as well as, you know, acting as a shining beacon of creativity right in the heart of Glasgow, I think will, you know, have those repercussions, those sort of ripple effects that we've talked about this morning elsewhere.
That's great. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. If I could ask some supplementaries along the back of this theme as well. So the wellbeing economy is one of the stated goals of the Scottish Government going forward, and how that meets expectations in our local communities. But we've also heard a lot of evidence about placemaking and the importance of the culture being relevant to the community and being in every community in our area. And also there's the, you know, responding to the audience, you know, what people are choosing to spend their leisure time doing, which is important as well. So I know it's not unusual for Creative Scotland funding models to be under scrutiny and controversy at the time, but for two particular areas I think that have been highlighted over COVID, it's what we maybe call the nighttime economy, but it's those performance spaces that are in comedy clubs, around music venues, around people, and we were hearing that for the first time ever they had got support, because they're very independent of government support because of COVID, but also the fact that the funding model may lead Creative Scotland grants to be out with the capacity of a lot of these organisations, and like a smaller funding model, a smaller grant might be available to support smaller projects, and that's got a rural and geographic element as well to it. And that so going forward, are these considerations going to be given to how the money is developed and the level of support that can be given to actually changing that placemaking in communities?
So placemaking, absolutely, and I think it really is an extremely pertinent concept when it comes to building around centres of production. So, for example, we have co-commissioned with Scottish Enterprise work that looks at how the economy around LEAF, going all the way out to Granton and the East Coast, can be developed as a consequence of a film studio, and likewise in Glasgow, to look at how we can bring together those elements, how we support local businesses to take advantage of that, looking at the whole supply chain and value chain. So that's definitely the case, and it's sort of interesting looking at the, if you like, the tension, hopefully a helpful tension, between building critical mass across the Central Belt with the wider effect across Scotland. And so, I think the screen industry is very alive to this. And if I look at the example of Good Omens, which is cited fully in Scotland, it'll be wholly made in Scotland. The showrunner, Douglas McKinnon, he deserves huge credit for bringing that show to Scotland, but also the way in which he wants to work with new entrants into the business through traineeships across the whole of Scotland. That's a model that we are extremely supportive of, obviously co-funding as well through various means. So absolutely there is a benefit to placemaking and looking strategically, working with local authorities, working with local industry on the range of training that can go on there. Going back to Kelvin Hall for a second, we have, for example, just set up what's called a format lab, which is a training program to ensure that that building, that facility, is employed by shows primarily that have come out of Scotland, as far as we can possibly help it, so that the way in which that will happen is not only having the building, but ensuring that the pipeline from Scotland is fully developed and commissionable. And so putting resource and expertise into the business of creating new shows that could go on there, I think, is one of those key contingencies that will make the place of it flourish in Scotland's best interest.
Okay. Mr. Munro, thanks.
In some of earlier answers, two or three occasions I've made reference to some examples that that I think are in part in response to this question. Things like the Place Programme and Place Partnerships Programme, Culture Collective and so on. I do want to clarify that in some of the emergency funds, certain parts of the nighttime economy are not in our traditional bailiwick in terms of our brief as Creative Scotland. So things like nightclubs, for example, we would not anticipate being in any way part of the kind of longer term support that we would be providing, unless there was a kind of cultural outcome attached to the funds that we were operating that they could address. And same for other wider parts of the nighttime economy who have previously been able to access support. So it's just about how we can cast future funding programmes that enable people to see and understand what the outcomes are intended from those programmes, and from there understand how they can make a contribution. I have to be honest, though, in certain instances, particularly where private business enterprise is involved, that because this is public funding that needs to be accounted for, there are certain fundamentals that we ask for in terms of application material around financials and business plans and so on that some private business enterprises, understandably, are reluctant to share and therefore can't satisfy the requirements of those funds to be able to come in and make the application. But I think in terms of the broad point about placemaking, I was referring earlier to the importance of really seeing communities more empowered to feel they have a stake and a say in what they want to see in their areas, and that the cultural sector is in tune with that and able to work with it and enable that to happen. I've mentioned earlier one of our core priorities is around equalities, diversity and inclusion, and it absolutely is in recognition of the fact that society pre-pandemic was unequal and in many ways unjust before, and that's widened and deepened during the course of the pandemic. So even more than ever, we have a determination and with those that we will be supporting to make sure that issues of access and inclusion in communities across Scotland are at the heart of that equation. But it will ultimately, unless there is growth in resources, make it more difficult to deliver against those agendas and make it more likely that we'll have to make tough choices, which will undoubtedly be sensitive and no doubt controversial. But it's really important that we in our commitment to things like equalities, diversity and inclusion, can see that through with all seriousness and conviction.
Okay, I'm looking, Dr. Allen, yes, thanks.
Yeah, just briefly on the back of that, I appreciate some of these issues have been covered, but as Columba would say, just one more question, but possibly relevant to both of you. You've mentioned there about how there's the potential for deepened inequality coming out of the experience of COVID. So I'm just curious to know whether that means you have to rethink specifically what you do in terms of your relationship with schools, which is obviously where efforts to overcome inequality usually begin in terms of public policy or preschool, I suppose. So I'm just curious to know whether you've had to rethink how you work with schools.
Okay, I'll go to Mr.
Munro
first, and then Ms. Davies.
Thank you. Again, the world, the extent to which the world has changed around us is still to clarify itself. But undoubtedly, absolutely agree with the point that a lot of work starts with children and young people, not just in school, but also in formal education and learning, which we do provide an awful lot of support for in a variety of different ways. But there's more to be done, and we have the Time to Shine strategy from before. We've got a National Youth Arts Advisory Group who are very clear that the voice of children and young people needs to be more at the heart of policy making and decision making. And we absolutely respect and would want to see that. So their ideas and aspirations for the future, and that count more than ever, I think. We've got a lot of support that we provide, so that's through funding, but we also work in our development role in partnership with bodies like Education Scotland, for example, to really understand how together we can support in-school teaching practice and in support of the Curriculum for Excellence, for example. And we'll continue to understand what more can be done in support of that kind of work to really ensure that creativity and a creative education is a key part of what we're we're able to enable through the work that we do. So I think, you know, it's a work that will continue to be in progress, but undoubtedly a very important dimension to what we want to do and see for the future, I think.
Okay, Ms. Davis.
And thank you very much for the question. We absolutely agree. I think that you know, access and inequality is underpinning a lot of our work. We know that there's more to do, but for example, working with GMAC in Glasgow, the Glasgow Media Access Centre, on bringing new diverse applicants into the system through making short films, for example, that's post-school age. You know, across all of our funded projects, we are looking for EDI activity and that proactive reach into underrepresented communities, likewise with cinemas. But I think on the school point, it's extremely well made. And we would say that actually Scotland is in the body opposition of being the one nation of the UK that doesn't have a school level qualification at NAT5 level that deals with film as an expressive art, and which seems, you know, odd for a country that has such a rich heritage and such an ambition for innovation in the future. It does feel absolutely key that at school age, young people are switched on not only to the idea of film or TV as a career of some sort, but that they are exploring their own creativity and expression, which may have manifold applications in later life. And you know, if we're thinking about what kind of country we want to be and how we go forward, it feels incredibly key that should be built into the education system. And, you know, referring back to something that John McVeigh said earlier about how his desire to see STEM become STEAM, you know, it's about having the arts and creativity taken seriously as you know, not a nice to have, but something that actually underpins the UK's economy and is a very, very growing part of it, and something that Scotland has seen can be us too. You know, with the right investment in infrastructure and skills, we can be part of that and should be part of it after all. So we absolutely agree with you that it starts in school and that there's more to be done.
Okay, Mr. Munro.
Thank you. Very quick point. I wanted to know, because it's relevant to many of the questions that have been asked today, I wanted to note the new initiative that we launched a couple of weeks ago called Our Creative Voice, which is an important advocacy programme which we've developed, but in partnership with people from across the sector. And it's a central repository where we want to speak to a general public as well as to politicians and the broader kind of sectors and stakeholders that we work with, where people can find case studies around what culture and creativity means to the people of Scotland in all the different policy areas and to all the different values that it can express. There's a whole range of materials on there, toolkits for people to use, but particularly the storytelling at the heart of it is a powerful body of work that will build over many months and the years ahead. And I would point people to be able to see it as that central repository, as the go-to place to find out more about the broad diversity and the great things that already happen in the country right across the policy spectrum. But it also contains a lot of material in support of the kind of data and the knowledge and research that sometimes comes up, and it was in the earlier session this morning about health, for example. There's an awful lot of material there that already exists in Our Creative Voice and will build, but it will have a thematic approach, currently moving to the environment, given COP's nearly upon us in a couple of months, and then children, young people and so on next year. So please do take the opportunity to look with that and engage with it, because it is powerful when you read and hear the work that is currently going on. But it's back to my earlier point about, if that's what we can achieve already on levels of resource, imagine what would be possible with just a little bit more, and what we could unleash by way of kind of positive contribution to the country culturally, socially and economically.
Okay, that's a positive note to end on, I think, this morning. So thank you both to Ms. Munro and Ms. Davis for the attendance at committee this morning. We will now move into private session for our final agenda item. Thank you.